everybody. Welcome to another episode of Beyond the Trailer Park. And yeah, I told everybody that we weren't having an episode this week. Guess what? I lied. it's been a weird couple of weeks because normally, as those of you who listen and watch know, we're usually Mondays at 7:30 p.m. But last week, we had Apostate Prophet on Thursday afternoon. And the week before, we had somebody else on Sunday. So I guess we're bucking the trend here because a little birdie told me earlier this week that David Silverman wanted to drop by and say hello. So, you know, we make accommodations sometimes. So good afternoon, David.
Good afternoon, Deborah. Thanks for having me back on the podcast. It's great to be here again.
Thank you. Well, hey, you know, I didn't have anything else to do this afternoon. So
fine.
Kidding. Actually, I just came from a massage, so you know.
Oh, nice.
I'm very lucky. I have a massage therapy clinic across the street from my house.
Oh, rock and roll. Nice job. That's a nice problem to have.
Exactly. So they always joke if I'm ever late, they're just going to throw shit at my window. And well, it's great to see you again. It's been a little while. We've changed a few things here and there since then, but good to see it. So you're running another convention this year.
I'm running another convention. We run a convention just about every year. We didn't run one, I believe, in 2016 because of the Reason Rally, but 2017 had a nice convention during the total solar eclipse. This year's convention is going to be a bit different, though. This year's convention is totally a thing. The convention is March 30th through April 1st. It's Easter weekend. We're going back to Easter weekend. We almost always have our conventions on Easter weekend because the rooms are cheap and atheists don't have anything else to do for the most part. And this year we've seen a trend in the convention circuit to have smaller conventions, private conventions, for-profit conventions, and we've seen a lot of conventions fall flat. And we've seen a lot of conventions get hostile. And not American Atheist conventions, but other conventions have gotten hostile. And other conventions still haven't even happened. And I really want to make the American Atheist Convention, which is, I believe, America's longest running convention, and it's also the largest atheist convention in the country, and it's the most fun atheist convention in the country. I wanted to make it different. We strive to make it different. We strive to make all of our conventions different. Deborah, we kind of knocked it out of the park this year. We have a speaker. Our keynote speaker is Hugh Laurie from House, and he is confirmed, and he is coming. And I'm having breakfast with him in a couple weeks. And he is all about our movement. He's all about American Atheists. And he is coming and he's going to be speaking from the stage and doing whatever the hell he wants. And that's just the main speaker. That's just the highlight speaker. We also have Barry Lynn coming from the Americans United from the Separation of Church and State. He was the executive director for 25 years, and he just retired. We also have Inna Shevchenko coming. And if you ever want to meet somebody who gets your blood boiling, if you ever want to meet somebody who you really, I mean, I look at Inna Shevchenko, and I think that she's a hero. And we've got her coming. She is the topless jihadi. She is the European woman. Yes. Yeah, she leads topless protests of Muslim imams and Muslim clerics in Europe, all over Europe. She's been in jail. She's been threatened. She's been evicted. She's been harassed in a real way. And she's caused major stir and major movement and conversation in Europe, not on a local basis, on a continental basis. She absolutely kicks ass. And I'm really excited to have her coming as well. It's coming together to be a really interesting convention, because one of the things that we're trying to do is bring it back to the positive side. You know, we're trying to negate all of the negative stuff that's been happening, all of the the asshole stuff that were happening. And so what's happening is we're making a convention that's welcoming. We're making a convention that's heartful. We're bringing in a huge charity food drive. Okay. Ooh. A huge charity food drive. The atheists are going to create packages for food. We're going to feed the hungry and the homeless at this convention. We're going to raise money for Muhammad al-Qadra, the founder of the Jordanian atheists, who had to flee Jordan because of harassment, and will also be at this convention.
Oh, fantastic.
Yeah. So, I mean, you've got so much heart mixed with so much activism. The tagline that we're, the unofficial tagline is hearts plus brains minus assholes. Okay.
Love it.
And I think that's really fitting. I think that's what this movement needs. Hearts and brains, not so much assholes. And every movement has their assholes, and every movement has that faction. And we're just not bringing that this year. We're bringing the heart. We're bringing the love. We're bringing the brains. We're bringing the activism. But Deborah, a lot of people don't understand. You know, I go on television, I go on the radio, and I go on debates, and I get all angry, and I the veins pop out of my forehead, and I'm like, all right.
Oh, you see when I'm debating on Facebook, man, like, woo.
But a lot of people don't understand that the heart of firebrand atheism is compassion.
Absolutely.
The heart of firebrand atheism is love. I get angry because people are being conned.
Yes.
I get angry because people are lying and being taken for granted. I get angry because this is happening to billions of people. And it's all a lie, and it's all a con, and it's all a scam, and it makes me mad. And so, yeah, I get upset about it, but it's about love. It's about kindness. When I say to somebody, when you say to somebody, you have your truth and I have my truth, it sounds kind. It is the opposite of kind. It is a selfish, self-centered, cowardly thing to say. You don't have your truth, and I don't have my truth. There is truth, and there is fiction. And when you say, oh, it's okay, your man in the sky is truth to you, what the hell are you doing? You're a coward. You're not telling the person the truth. You know it's a lie, and you're saying, okay, I'm just going to say it. I'm too much of a fucking coward to tell you to your face like an adult that you believe in a man in the sky and it's silly. So I'm going to let it happen to you. I'm going to be lazy. I'm going to be cowardly. I don't want to have a fighty whitey. I'm going to let you live this lie because I don't want to have any sort of a discussion. That's cowardice. When I say to you, no, your man in the sky is wrong. Your God is fiction. Even if I know you're going to hate hearing it, I'm still doing a kind act. I'm still being kind. I'm not saying you're stupid, but your belief is stupid. I'm not saying you're an idiot, but your beliefs are wrong. And when we say it correctly and when we say it passionately, we can get the point across. But when we cower from that, we shelter religion. We help religion. We foster the lie. We foster the falsehood. And so the heart of firebrand atheism, and this is what I talk about in my book, Fighting God, which is now out on paperback. We have a newer version of Fighting God. It's out on paperback, and everybody should buy it. But if we cower from that, we are doing religion a favor.
Yes.
We are doing ourselves We're doing ourselves a favor. We're being selfish. We are not doing a favor. We are not at all being nice, and we are not at all being humanistic to the victims of the lie to whom we are speaking. We are being cowards.
Yeah, and this is why I enjoyed your book so much, and I do tell people to read it all the time.
Thank you.
Because I agree. It's we're not doing anybody a favor by letting them believe something that's not true. And I always feel so terrible for people who waste their lives, you know, doing things to please something that doesn't exist. Like where I live, we have Mennonites a lot in the area. And every time I see one in a store, I'm just thinking, oh, you poor person, you know, you're driving around in a horse and buggy wearing that you know, silly outfit because you think it's going to get you somewhere after you die, and it's not. And you should be out living life and learning how to drive a car and having an iPhone if you want one, and all of those things. Like,
and Deborah, those people are raising kids.
Exactly.
Those people are raising kids. And those kids, how are we doing those kids a favor? How are we being good?
Yeah.
When we go to a mother of Mennonite children, children who are all in uniform, who all think in this tiny little box. And we're not just talking about Mennonites. You can talk to them about, you know, any religious cult, any religion. How are we doing those kids a favor by legitimizing that? We are doing those kids a favor. I'll tell you how to do those kids a favor. Get in the parents' faces and tell them that they're doing wrong by their kids. Because guess what those parents are doing? Those parents are doing exactly what their parents told them to do.
That's right. And that's why religion is hereditary.
Of course.
I think you've mentioned it in your book, you know, if you were born in the Middle East, you'd be a Muslim. If you were born in Israel, you'd be a Jew. Like, that's just how it works. And nobody grows up going, oh, well, I think I'm going to try this religion. You're told this is what's right. This is what's true. This is what you need to believe. And what really breaks my heart is the people that say, and if you differ from what I tell you, I'm not going to allow you to be my child.
No, isn't that awful? I mean, think about that. When religion gets between, and again, when religion gets between parent and child, there's nothing stronger, right? Between parent and child, that should be like the top of the food chain. The link between parent and child should be top of the food chain. And religion says, no. You're man in the sky and you are the top of the food chain. Who tells you what the man in the sky says? The preacher. The preacher inserts himself between you and your child. And we're doing them a favor by saying, oh, you have your truth and I have my truth. And oh, you think it's religion and I'm going to respect your beliefs. How in the world is that doing good? How in the world is that kind? How in the world is that humanistic? It's not.
It's not.
It's heartless and cowardly. It's awful.
And really, when you think about it, it's selfish, because why are they doing that? Because they want God to think that they're a good parent, not that they are a good parent. They want God to think that they're doing their job and creating, you know, the next generation of little whatever religion.
And they find out if God likes them by their preacher telling them so.
That's right.
So their God likes them if their preacher likes them. Their God loves them if their preacher loves them. Their God thinks they're doing good if their preacher thinks they're doing good. And how do you get the preacher doing good? By making baby congregants, by giving money, and by giving the preacher more power and more money and more love and whatever the preacher wants. That's how you get good in God's eyes.
My family wasn't overly religious. And I remember as a young child, when we went to my grandparents who were religious and they wanted to pray over dinner. And I remember thinking as like a 5-year-old, 6-year-old, this is stupid. Why are we doing this? Mm-hmm. And then I got sent to vacation Bible school and told that I was going to burn in hell for all eternity. And then it scared the shit out of me. And I decided to believe it.
Mm-hmm. Of course, you were terrified. How is that nice?
Not at all.
How is that good? If you meet a parent and the parent says, oh, I send my kid to vacation Bible school, and you say, oh, that's nice. How are you being a good person? How are you being nice? How are you being a humanist? How are you caring? How are you caring? Because somebody is brainwashing their kids, terrifying their kids, terrorizing their own children because their preacher wants them to.
That's like the people in the Middle Ages that thought they were doing people a favor by burning them at the stake because they'll go back in a pure state.
Well, like, yeah, it's everybody believes in a God that agrees with them. And this is an important point that people need to understand. Everybody believes in a God. And it's a roundabout argument. And I talk about this a little bit in Fighting God. But if you look at the people who if you look at the Muslim terrorists who took down 9/11 or who went gunning down innocent civilians in Paris, okay? They're walking down the street. They're gunning down innocent civilians in Paris. If you asked your neighbor, your Muslim neighbor, the nice people not down the street that your kids play with, if you ask them what they thought about those terrorists in the streets of Paris, I guarantee you they will say they're not real Muslims.
Yeah.
And I guarantee you, if you go to those terrorists in the streets of Paris, they will talk about your neighbor and say they're not real Muslims.
Real Muslims.
And if you go to the Westboro Baptist Church and ask them about the Catholics, they're not real Christians. If you go to the Catholics, the Westboro Baptist Church is not real Christians. Why? Because there's no such thing as a real Christian. There's no such thing as a real Muslim. There's no such thing as a real Jew. Everyone believes in a God that agrees with them. It's all individual. All of it. And so if it's all individual, everybody's equal. If it's all individual, why in the world do we have, why in the world is it okay to say, I'm going to brainwash my kid into believing what I believe? Why is it okay for you to sit back and do that? There's nothing in any one religion over any other religion that's more, that makes it more relevant. There's nothing about any religion that makes it more right. And I've said this in the book, and I've said it to you, and I've said it, and I'll say it to you, I've said it to your listeners before, the sum total of scientifically valid proof for anything supernatural ever across all religions is zero. And if anybody anywhere can prove me wrong once, I'll quit my job.
And you're still, you still have your job. You've been saying that.
And nobody's even tried.
Yep.
Nobody's even tried. Everybody says, well, there's miracles everywhere. Okay, show me one. Anywhere. Show me. Don't tell me about it. Show me.
Yep.
I got a guy. I know a guy who regrew his arm. Oh, really? Great. Give me his name. Give me his phone number. Let's see it. I know a person who was healed. Okay, great. Show me the before blood tests. Show me the after blood tests.
Yep.
And let's see the difference. Show me somebody who was cured by diabetes.
I would love I would love not to have diabetes. That'd be awesome.
And by the way, we can expand this to any ghost hunter show, any psychic, okay? The Ghost Hunters has been on the air for 11 seasons. It's very reasonable to suspect that in those 11 seasons and in all the spin-offs from all the other countries that are in this show, it's reasonable to assume that they've found one ghost.
Okay, I was a ghost hunter for 4 years.
Uh-huh. Right?
Guess what I saw?
How many ghosts did you see?
None. Zero.
None. How surprising.
I went to Waverly Hills Sanatorium, which is supposed to be one of the most haunted buildings in all of North America. Mm-hmm. There, all the things happen here all the time. I crawled inside the morgue drawer, okay? And guess what? Nothing.
Nothing happened. Amazing. It's almost like it's all a lie. So when we look at the society, when we look at our society, we see the society is poisoned by these lies. And we say that, okay, well, good, getting back to religion, that religion is somehow elevated, that we have to treat religion carefully because you have your closely held religious beliefs and that's precious. But it's not. Closely held religious beliefs is simply believing in a God that agrees with you. Those people walking down the streets of Paris were sure God agreed with them. Those people they were gunning down, those children, they owed them a thank you. Because they were going to heaven early.
Yes. Oh, and the big one, and Ali Rizvi talks about this a lot, is the mass school shooting in Pakistan, where somebody went in, a bunch of militant Muslims went in and killed a bunch of school children. Mm-hmm. And they were, their justification was, well, they go straight to heaven. You know, we don't feel bad that we shot all these children. Allah takes them straight to heaven. It's okay.
Yeah, it's okay. And how is religion good again? How is it okay? How is this great? Because it all legitimizes itself. All religion legitimizes itself. The peaceful Muslims legitimize Islam, and it makes us defensive of people like that because, oh, they have closely held religious beliefs. Closely held religious beliefs are bullshit. They're just opinions. And they're not valid opinions. They're fantasies. Closely held religious beliefs are nothing more than elevated fantasies that we are protecting with our own zeitgeist. We are protecting with the idea that they have some sort of special place because you believe in a God. So we, all religion elevates all religion, and all religion protects and legitimizes all religion. And that's why all religion needs to die. It's one of the reasons that all religion needs to die, because there is no such thing as a true Christian or a true Muslim or a true Jew or a true Hindu. Everything is individual. Well, everything is individual. What?
True fake.
It's all individual. It's all fake. And it all needs to die. And that's a very kind and nice thing to say. To say that religion deserves to die, not religious people, obviously, folks. Don't conflate this with an attack on humans. I'm talking about the lie of religion. All religion is a lie. All religion deserves to die.
You don't have to do anything negative or violent or anything that to get religion to die. You do things like hold conferences and educate
people. Well, and talk and not coddle it and not say horrible lies, horrible things like you have your truth and I have mine. And we're just going to let it sit. We're just going to agree to disagree. Fuck no, don't agree to disagree. Get in that face and disagree. Get in that face. Say, why do you believe in your religion other than the fact that your mommy and daddy believed in the same religion? Oh, really? Nothing? Well, if somebody else believes in a different religion for no other reason than that their mommy and their daddy believed in that God, does that make them right? Exactly. No. So what exactly makes you right? Go into it, folks. Yes, they don't want to talk about it because we're right and they're wrong. The reason that it's politically correct, incorrect to talk about religion is because religion wants it to be politically incorrect to talk about religion, because the more you talk about it from a critical standpoint, the stupider and more real, the more silly it sounds, the more wrong, the more obviously wrong it is. There's nobody out there that wants you to talk about how wrong their religion is to them. You got to do it anyways, because people need, and they'll get angry because they have never even thought the thought process of why their religion is right. They just believe it. And they just say, well, I believe because, and I choose to believe, and my parents believed, and it's all a tradition, and none of that makes it true. And none of that, and if none of that makes it true, then that does make it your business as a good person to get between somebody's religion and somebody's children. Absolutely. And it's an act of kindness to convert people. It's an act of kindness to talk about religion to people.
I know a lot of people who became atheists by trying to be the best at whatever religion it was and delving it. You know, I want to be the best Christian I can be, and maybe I want to be a pastor. And they've researched and they tried to know it inside out and backwards. And then what happens? They realize how awful it is. Mm-hmm. Because how many people never study what they're told to believe? Like, most.
I remember, Deborah, I gave a speech some years ago now at a seminary. And after the speech, I gave the speech at the seminary. And after the speech, I went to the bathroom. I came out of the bathroom and there was a whole crowd of young people there, seminary students out there. And they started asking me questions, you know, just on the stairs.
Yeah.
And I asked them how many of them had read the Bible. None of them. None of them. And that you could see it in their face that they were looking down and they knew they were wrong. They knew. And what did I do? Did I say, oh, it's okay? No. I scolded every single one of them. You are dedicating your life to a book you haven't even read because your mommy and daddy say so. You are dedicating your life and you haven't even read it. You're sure you're right, but you haven't even read the source material.
And
I dare everybody all the time.
Read it. Absolutely.
Read the Bible. Pick it up. And I'm not talking about reading a piece. Pick it up.
Read all of it.
Read every word. If it's the perfect word of God, you'll know. Absolutely. And if it's a collection of stories written over the course of 1,000 years or so by multiple nomadic, barely literate people who knew very little, you'll know that too.
And it's not just Christianity. Like, I've pushed into Islam quite a bit, and I debate Muslims all the time. And half of them, I'm reading the Quran as a podcast right now. So I've read bits and pieces, and there's certain parts that I've studied because they're important verses, but I've not read the whole thing. Mm-hmm. And even I know more than the average Muslim. It's pathetic, you know. What is the significance of Quran 65:4? Or what does it say? What you don't know.
It's and the thing about the Quran is that a lot of Muslim people memorize it, but they don't speak the language.
That's right.
So they memorize the Arabic because the Quran is melodic in Arabic, and they don't know what it says.
That's right.
And so a lot of times they just, I mean, it's, we should, the same is true with the Bhagavad Gita. The same is true with Jews and the Torah and the Talmud. Nobody reads the Talmud. Very few people read the Torah. And when they do read the Torah, it's in Hebrew. They don't speak Hebrew. And if they do speak Hebrew, they just go through it. They don't actually talk about it. It's ridiculous how much people marry their texts without knowing what it says. Mm-hmm. And I think that it's imperative that people understand that, you know, this is how we know we're right. Okay. If you read lots and lots of atheist books completely, you'll stay an atheist.
Yes.
If you read the Bible completely, you'll become an atheist.
Yes.
If you read the Quran completely, you'll become an atheist. If you read the Torah, you'll realize you're an atheist. This is how we know we're right. The more we talk about religion, the more obvious atheism becomes, and the more obvious the lie of religion becomes. And that's why it's good for us. That's how we know we're right. And if anybody anywhere one time can prove us wrong, anyone anywhere can prove me wrong once, I'll quit my job, because I don't want to be wrong. I want to be right. I don't want to be the president of American Atheists if American Atheist is wrong. I don't want to be the president of American Atheists if atheism is wrong. I want to be the president of whatever organization is saying the right thing. And so show me anytime once. And again, any psychic, any ghost, any miracle, anywhere, anytime, prove one. And I'll quit my job. And I'm not even remotely worried, because it's all a lie. It's all a con, and it's all a scam. And again, it's nice and good and kind for us to say that. It's important for us to say that, because if we don't say it, nobody else will.
Right. Have you seen the videos that I've been seeing lately of people supposedly getting risen from the dead?
No. I'll bet you $1 million they're not getting risen from the dead.
I will. The first guy showed me one. It was actually a couple of years ago, but I'm seeing them more and more now. A lot of them are coming out of Africa for some reason, but showed me is like, oh, look, there's a Nigerian preacher called TB Joshua. He's absolutely total freak charlatan, but he's like, look,
no,
he's raising this old guy from the dead. And I'm like, okay. So I look at this video and they show a guy on the floor. Right. And people are like, oh, and weeping and wailing and whatever. And he's just laying on the floor. There's no EMS. There's no electrodes. There's no medical personnel of any sort whatsoever. And then they show, oh, they carry him off and put him in a bed, and everybody's weeping and wailing. And this TB Joshua comes in and like blows in his ear or something. It's like, oh, look, I'm alive. And I'm like, are you fucking kidding me? Like,
wow, that's amazing. I'm sure that's absolutely true.
But, I know.
But think about it, though. Okay, so that's an obvious scam. That's an obvious scam. So if you talk to somebody in that audience and they're a believer, and you say, well, okay, that's your truth, and that's not my truth, but it's your truth. How in the world are you being nice? How in the world are you being kind? This is what we have to talk about more. This is the subject that we have to talk about. This is what I talk about in Fighting God, and this is what we're going to be talking about at the American Atheist Convention. It's kind to be a firebrand atheist. It's good. We are the nice guys. The veins popping out of our forehead are veins of love.
That's
this
right.
is caring. I'm angry. The people say to me, oh, you're so angry. Yes, I'm angry. I'm angry because people are being taken advantage of, and I care because I'm a good person. It's not about being hateful. There's no hate in me at all.
You need the veins popping out of my head are veins of love. You need to make a shirt.
It's important that people understand that we yell because we care. We yell because we love. Love is what we're doing here. And, you know, there are lots of people, even in our movement, who rebel against that, who say, no, the nice thing to do is to be nice and hold hands and let's hug and feel and get along. And you know what? If I were to be in a situation where somebody was saying, hey, you know what, let's get along. Let's you and I put our differences aside and do something for a common goal. Yeah, I can do that. Okay. Temporarily.
Mm-hmm.
For a common goal. I can work with people of religion, with religious people toward a common goal. But don't ask me to legitimize your religion. Don't ask me to tell you that your religion is good. Don't ask me to tell you that your religion is fair. And if you got kids, don't ask me to be quiet around your kids, because your kids need to hear that mommy and daddy could be wrong.
That's right.
And I wish that somebody had told you that mommy and daddy could be wrong when you were a kid.
Yeah.
Because mommy and daddy can be wrong. And yes, atheist mommy and daddies could be wrong too. Read books and learn for yourself. Read all the books, start to finish. Don't pick and choose. Read the pros, read the cons, read religious books too. Read it all. Learn, think, go. You'll be an atheist. That's why we know we're right. There's no fear in my mind that if you give a kid a lot to read on both sides of the issue, that they'll change over. That they'll become religious. Nobody says, wow, Mormonism makes so much sense from a secular point of view. Nobody.
I really want a pair of magic underwear, you know? I'm gonna convert.
Nobody does that. The only reason anyone converts to any religion is because of indoctrination. The only reason anyone is in a religion is because of indoctrination. Nobody says, wow, the Catholic Church makes so much sense from the outside. I'm gonna go join. That doesn't happen. What does happen is people join because they get married, or people join because they're pressured into it, or because they're converted into any religion at all. Nobody says, wow, this religion makes sense from a logical perspective, therefore I'm going into it from an atheist perspective. That does not happen, because if it did, we would all be there.
That's
everybody
right.
Everybody who believes in a God has been indoctrinated into that God. And a lot of times, so many times, people will say, no, I was an atheist and then I converted. But were they?
I've had a few people say that, but I'll bet you
$1 billion they believe in a God that their parents believed in.
Oh,
I'll
yeah.
bet you $1 billion they believe in. Nobody says, I was an atheist, I was born a Christian, but then I was an atheist and then I converted to Hinduism because I looked into it. They always convert to the religion that they've been indoctrinated into as children, because they think it's bullying. They think it's my mommy and daddy's God or no God.
Or they think, oh, I was rebelling against my parents when I thought I was an atheist, or I was just a bad kid, and you know, they really were right and I should listen to my parents and that kind of bullshit.
Yeah, and it's all about indoctrination. Nobody converts to another religion on their own because they think it's a good idea. I know nobody who has done that. They all say, oh, well, I converted and I did it on my own. But when you probe just a bit, you'll see, oh, wait a minute, you actually converted to the religion your parents believed in, right? You don't believe in a different God that you were raised in, though, right? No, I'm in a different sect of my religion, therefore I call myself a convert. No, you went from a Christian to a Christian, right? You went from a Jew to a Jew. You went from a Muslim to a Muslim, right? Yes, yeah. You did. And that happens nearly 100% of the time, because religion is indoctrination and only indoctrination. There is no reason to believe in religion ever at all, except for indoctrination. And if anybody can prove me wrong on that, give it to me. I dare you. I will quit my job if anybody can show me any evidence anywhere for anything. Any evidence anywhere for anything. please own how right we are. We need to understand how correct we are. It's not my truth versus your truth. It is right versus wrong. It is fact versus fiction. And if you're helping somebody believe in fiction, if you're legitimizing fiction, you're hurting them. And you need to own that you're hurting them. You need to own that you're being lazy. You need to own that you're being cowardly. You need to own that you're being selfish as hell, unless you actually have the guts to say to somebody, no, you are wrong. Let's talk about this. Let me show you why you're wrong. Let me show you why it's not making sense. Let me show you why I'm right and you're wrong. That is the kind thing to do, especially if there's children involved. That's the nice thing to do. And that's why we're having that. That's one of the reasons that I'm the president of American Atheists, because I care so strongly about other people.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I love the idea of what you were saying, how you can work with people who are religious. So let's say you can work at a food bank with a bunch of Christians, but that doesn't mean you have to pray with them. And when they start, and it doesn't mean, you know, when they say, oh, I'll come fellowship with you, he's like, why would I want to do that? Let me explain to you why that does not interest me. And you don't have to be a dick about it. You can be completely polite and respectful as a human towards.
Yes.
Absolutely. I've done it myself lots of times. You get, I did go to the convention in Milwaukee, and I had 3 different conversations the same night with believers in the hotel, and were very respectful and calm, and nobody got upset, and they asked interesting questions, and one guy didn't even know he was a deist, and I told him what that meant. Oh, I guess that's what I am.
Yep.
You know, you can have those discussions and tell them that they're wrong without being a dick.
And it's your moral imperative to do so. People need to know that it's their moral imperative to do so. And that's what we're saying. It's the nice thing to do to help people convert themselves away from religion. It's the nice thing to do. It's the kind thing to do to challenge people on their religion. Even if they say, even if they get mad, even if they get irritated, even if they storm off, it's still the kind humanistic thing to do to not let people get away with believing that their man in the sky is somehow special. Nobody's man in the sky is special. Closely held religious beliefs are nothing more than fantasies. They are nothing more than personal opinions and fantasies bolstered by our zeitgeist, bolstered by our society, bolstered in many cases by atheists who legitimize it by saying lies like, you have your truth and I have my truth.
Every time I see a coexist shirt or sticker, I just want to cringe.
See, so coexisting is, and so, yes, we have to coexist with people. And, you know, nobody is talking about violence. Nobody's talking about not existing with people. But at the same time, coexist is a pretty toxic idea. Think about it. Coexist is a pretty toxic idea. Am I supposed to, am I, and who does this benefit? If you got a Muslim family on one side of your house, and a Christian family on another side of your house, and a Jewish family across the street, and they all have kids, and we're coexisting, who benefits from me not saying anything? The kids don't, the families don't, I don't. Who benefits from me not saying anything? Oh, the religions benefit from it. They're the ones that benefit. They're doing the coexist. It's not about coexistence. It's about communication. It's about argument. It's about helping people. It's about humanism, real humanism, caring about other people, caring about those kids, making sure that those kids know that, guess what? Mom and dad are wrong. Yes, say the words. Mom and dad are wrong about God. Say it to children. And you are helping children when you do. And you are going against the zeitgeist of America. You're going against what people say is the kind thing to do. But you are being kind nonetheless. Telling children of religious parents that mom and dad are wrong about God is the nicest thing you can do for those kids, because it'll plant a seed. It'll tell them that there are other people. Mom and dad are wrong about God. Your preacher is wrong about God. How do you know your mom and dad are right about God anyways? Just because they say so? What if somebody else's mom and dad thinks a different God is true? Does that make it real? No, it doesn't. Give these kids some Socratic help. Give these kids some voice. give them the ability, the tools to think. It's the kind thing to do. This is the nice thing to do. And so many people I have talked to in atheism have said to me, gee, I wish somebody said that to me when I was a kid. I wish somebody just even suggested the possibility to me when I was a kid. We can do that. And it's the kind, nice thing to do. Yes, it'll make it a little bit harder on them because guess what? Learning the truth is more difficult than living a fantasy. That's why fantasies exist. Fantasies are better than reality. They are, but they're not real. And they set you up to be controlled, and they set you up to have kids that are controlled, and they set you up to believe lies like ghost hunters and religion. And we as good people need to own how right we are and how wrong they are. And it's not our truth versus your truth. It's not equal. Everybody has equal rights, but that doesn't mean we have equal ideas. That doesn't mean the atheism idea is equal to the religion idea. Yes, legally we have the rights. You have the right to be as religious as you want. I have the right to be as religious or non-religious as I want. Those rights are equal, but that doesn't mean the ideas are equal. The only idea that has any merit at all is atheism. All religion has zero merit, all of it.
Yep. And we're always taught, you know, oh, well, if you in play company or, you know, you shouldn't talk about religion at functions and whatnot. I'm like, why the hell not?
Right.
If somebody's going to get upset that you're challenging their religion in a friendly conversation, what does that say about what they actually truly think about their religion if they're honest with themselves?
That's right.
Because if you're confident, like, I never have a problem talking about being an atheist to anybody because I know I'm right.
Yeah.
And I have nothing to worry about. I don't have, like you said, you'll quit your job. You have no worries that you're going to be unemployed anytime soon.
None.
I'm not worried that I'm going to have to stop podcasting anytime soon because I don't fear it. So if somebody is freaking out and getting upset that you want to talk and challenge what they believe, that means that real deep down, if they're honest, they have doubts.
That's right.
And they don't want to look at those doubts because they're comfortable where they are.
Exactly. And still, it's the nice thing to do to challenge them on it. It's the nice thing to do to get them out of it. And it doesn't matter how old they are. It doesn't matter if they're 10 or 100 years old. There's never too late to give person the truth. And you know what? If you tell your grandmother that she's wrong, even though she's lived her entire life as a Catholic, Christian, Jew, whatever, they won't drop dead when they hear the truth. They won't. They're not going to have a Fred Sanford or a heart attack and fall over and die because you tell them, I'm coming, Elizabeth. Remember that show? They're not going to do that. That's not really a thing. They're going to, something that I've learned, I'm 51 years old. And as a 51-year-old guy, I have something to tell people who are 25. Old people can think too. old people can think. Old people can handle it. Okay? And when I'm 80 or 90 or 110, I hope nobody has the disrespect for me to say, oh, Dave couldn't handle a challenge. Dave couldn't handle hearing the truth. That's a horribly disrespectful position to have. I respect my elders enough to tell them the truth and treat them like adults, not like frail little children who are going to break. They're not going to break. They're not going to die. They're going to be fine.
There was a video a few months ago, I think in the spring, I saw, and it was of a woman in her 90s who had recently become an atheist.
Yeah.
And she had been, I forget whether she was Jewish or Christian, but she'd been following her religion, you know, 90 some years and raised a family and you know, been through at least one husband. I don't remember the details, but she was talking about how glad she was that she was, you know, not going to die not knowing that it was all bullshit. And she was living, you know, enjoying her life and like, wow, you know, I can do X, Y, Z now because I don't believe in those silly things.
Right.
Her 90s. And I thought, this is so incredible. Like, what a beautiful thing. You know, maybe she did waste some time with some things that she could have enjoyed, but damn it, she's going to do what she can now.
Absolutely. That's the best. That's an important time. When your time left is short, spend it well.
Yes.
You know, don't waste whatever. If you're 90 years old, now's a great time to convert to the truth. And it's not about, you know, dogma. It's about reading and learning what is actually real and figuring out what actually real is.
And talk about the courage to make that change when you have been in the comfort zone your entire life. That's courage to say no. Yes, I could believe this and you know, be contented forever. But why would I want to believe? It's that old thing. I'd rather believe a difficult truth than a comfortable lie.
Right.
And she had the courage to do that.
And there's a lot to admire in that. You know, there's a lot to admire when you're fighting the indoctrination and habit of 90 years. There's a lot to overcome there, and it's hard. That's a hard thing to do. But if you can do that, it's something that I would truly, really admire in a person. Absolutely. And old people can do that.
They can. They absolutely
and so, can. And so I'm, you know, I want to just make sure that I get all this information out. The American Atheist National Convention is, again, hearts plus brains minus assholes. We're creating a welcoming environment, a loving environment. Everybody who's not an asshole is welcomed. Okay. And if you're formerly an asshole and you want to not be an asshole, please come, because redemption is a thing. And, you know, it's nobody's holding any grudges or of anything. Just come and be nice and be pleasant and come and help us raise money for Muhammad from Jordan. Come and help us raise money for the food and pack food for the hungry. Come and listen to Hugh Laurie live on stage and Ina Shevchenko. And I'll tell you something, Deborah. A lot of people tell me that I get them riled up.
Yeah.
That I get them humped up.
You do.
Ina Shevchenko gets me riled up. Ina Shevchenko is my Dave Silverman, okay? And when you hear this woman speak, your blood is going to boil. Barry Lynn will do the exact opposite, because he's so mild and he's so nice and he's so sweet, but he's also brilliant, and he's got a fantastic experience running Americans United for 25 years, and he's such a sweet guy. And we've got an entire slew of other people coming to this convention. Yvette Guinevere is going to be there. Yvette Daltremont. Anthony Magnabosco is going to be there. Kim Abel is going to be there. Our MC is Victor Harris. He's a poet and a cheesecake chef. And by the way, his cheesecake is awesome. It's going to be so diverse and so beautiful. I mean, it's really shaping up to be a really great convention. Oh, and by the way, the price. Not only are our conventions among the lowest price conventions in the movement, but we have student pricing, military pricing, and hardship pricings. If you can't afford to come, you can come. We've got pricing there that's made for you. So please come any way you can. It's in Oklahoma City. It's at the Sheraton in Oklahoma City. It's a beautiful hotel downtown, right next to the Brick Avenue area, where people can go and walk and go up and down the bars. And we're going to have parties every night. We're going to have music every night, parties every night, and we're going to have comedy. We've got Leanne Lord as a confirmed comedian coming to do comedy night on Friday night. And we're having a special after party on Sunday for everybody who participates in the food drive. Everybody who participates in the food packing drive gets a free after party. And we're going to have a ton of fun at this party. The objective is to leave the event with your face sore from smiling too much.
Oh, yeah. And I bet Hugh Laurie is going to be hilarious. I don't know. You may know him from House. I've known him about him since the 80s, and I used to watch him on Blackadder.
Yeah.
And then Fry and Laurie after that. The man is comedy genius.
Yeah, he is. He really is a very, very versatile person. And I'm really happy that he's agreed to join us. And But he's coming. I'm just thrilled. I believe it's the first A-level celebrity to come to an atheist convention in the country. And I'm really excited that he's coming to the American Atheist National Convention. By the way, once again, the website for that convention is atheists.org. The website for American Atheists is atheists.org. The website for the convention, where everybody should go, is atheists.org/convention2018. And my book is just out on paperback. It's called Fighting God. And I wrote an epilogue for Fighting God for the paperback for about Trump and Pence, because Fighting God was originally published before Trump and Pence. So I had to add on a piece for the paperback version, Fighting Trump and Pence, because we have a problem. We've got a lot of issues, and a lot of people are ready to pack up. A lot of people are ready to give up. And this is not the time to give up. This is the time to dig in. Right. And that's one of the things that we're going to be doing at the AACon. We're going to be gearing you up and cheering you up. And we're going to make your heart filled, and we're going to make your brain filled, and we're going to create a welcoming, nourishing environment for everybody. I hope everybody comes to the American Atheist National Convention. Fill those seats. Bring your friends. Hugh Laurie is in the house.
And I have the link is in the show description.
So thank you so much.
Click on through and all the information is there. You can get tickets right there, all of that fun stuff. So yes, absolutely go do that, because it sounds amazing.
I am so excited for this convention. It's just, I mean, I was excited. I get excited for all our conventions, right? I got excited for last year's convention for the total eclipse, but this year's convention is feeling different. It's feeling different because it's feeling positive. It's feeling loving, and it's feeling big. It's feeling big. And the tickets are selling a lot because Hugh Laurie. So we're selling a lot of tickets. There's a lot of people coming. There are still rooms in the room block in the main hotel, which is the Sheraton. So that's all on at atheist.org/2018. And I hope everybody can come to this and get in there quickly, because you know, we are going to max out the hotel, I expect, on this one, because obviously we've got low pricing and big stars. So I expect this convention to sell a lot. And so I hope everybody gets in there. And you know, Deborah, thanks for having me on the show. I really enjoy coming on here and just talking to you. And, you know, I think it happens every time I come on here that you say, "So, Dave, what's new?" And then I talk for 20 minutes, and then you say, "Oh, really?" And I talk for another 20 minutes. And so, yeah, thanks.
But you know what? I'm usually the big mouth, so I'm okay with that.
Okay. I remember once, way long ago, 1997, maybe, I interviewed Douglas Adams, who wrote The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. And we had, this interview has been, I don't know where this interview is. I still have to find it, but the interview was me asking Douglas a question, and then Douglas talking for a long time. And then me asking another question and Douglas talking for a long time. It was a lot of fun. And so that I kind of remind myself of him in that way now.
Well, I am so glad that you wanted to come by and say hi and tell me about everything. I think it's a great idea. It's a great time by the sounds of it. And everybody should absolutely go. And all of you Canadians, if you can get to Oklahoma City, go down there.
Yeah.
But it sounds like a lovely place.
Oh, Oklahoma City is not bad. You know, they have running water. Yeah. They have paved streets. There's no tumbleweeds at all. And like, I was there for like an entire weekend. There were no gunfights in the middle of the street at all. None. I kid. Oklahoma City is actually a really nice city, and it's clean and safe. And there's this area called the Brick, which is this walking street, a lot like BL Street in Memphis. This is walking street where you just go to the bars, and it's really friendly, and it's right nearby. And so it's really going to be a festive atmosphere. Is going to be a happy atmosphere, because the heart of Firebrand Atheism is love and compassion. It really is. And so I hope everybody can come, you know, and that sings well with Canadians. Canadians are all into love and compassion. Oh, so that means like all you Canadian watchers of this podcast have to come.
Yes.
You have to come.
Lots of opportunity to say sorry that weekend.
Well, we're the ones saying sorry these days with our president.
Well, we say sorry for you.
I do. And we need all the sorry we can get with this president, but we do have a lot to talk about. We do have a lot of activism to do, and we have a lot of people to help. And it's important to understand that we're doing it because of kindness, because of love, because of compassion. And that's why we're passionate. And that's why we're angry. And that's why I hope everybody comes to the American Atheist Convention, March 30th through April 1st, Easter weekend in Oklahoma City, atheists.org/2018.
Awesome. And just a quick note before we wrap up. Yeah. So as I mentioned, we weren't supposed to have a show this week, but I will remind everybody that we are having a show on Monday night as per usual. And we're talking to Esther Palmer, who is formerly of the FLDS out of Bountiful, BC. So we're super excited to talk to her. She has an amazing story, and it's one that everybody needs to know. So do tune in for that. That's 7:30 p.m. on Monday. And of course, Full Quranic, I will be dropping an episode tomorrow. The next batch of Quran readings. Yay. We just love our Allah, let me tell you.
Yay, Allah, most merciful.
47 chapters, and all it is Allah threatening us about what all the nasty things he's going to do if we don't kiss his ass. That's all it's been.
Sounds like the Old Testament to me.
Uh-huh. Oh, yeah. Oh, there's a lot of plagiarizing going on, let me tell you.
Muhammad
is not a very original thinker at all. Bet.
If you want to read something truly original, you should check out the Book of Mormon, because that's completely original and not plagiarized at all.
Not at all. Not at all. In fact, I think Joseph Smith must have either known about Muhammad or known a Muslim, because those two guys were two peas in a pod, let me tell you. But anyway, again, thank you so much, David, for dropping in. I really appreciate it.
Deborah, and thank you so much for having me on the show, having a show for me to talk about the convention, and for talking about American Atheists, and for talking about Fighting God. And thank you for reading Fighting God and for telling people to read it.
I love the book. I'm always telling people, especially theists who like to tell me that their religion is the fastest growing religion, blah, blah, blah. I'm like, oh, really? Do I have a book for you?
I got data. I have actual data to back myself up. Actual
numbers, tangible, you know?
Yeah.
Like, look it up and verify it.
Quantitative data from multiple independent sources that you can look up and challenge me on. And not too many people do, because the numbers don't lie.
Absolutely. You got that right.
You bet.
All right, everybody. Well, I'll just lead us out with our human creed for mankind, and we'll see everybody on Monday. And again, thanks a lot, David.
Thank you, Deborah.
Oh, Danny. Wrong button.
That was the wrong button.
Know the truth yes, and power was. Of reason and of rational thinking, and I will use them to my advantage. I know the truth and power of educating myself and of expanding my intellectual boundaries, and I will educate myself. I know the truth and power of vanquishing ignorance, and I will do so whenever the opportunity presents itself. I know the truth and power of morality without supervision and of true and accurate righteousness. I know the truth and power of obliterating tyranny, be it intellectual, emotional, or philosophical, and will work toward that goal whenever and however possible. I know the truth and power of human ingenuity. I know the truth and power of human compassion, and I will be mindful of the welfare of others. I know the truth and power of equality and fairness for all living things. I know the truth and power of the importance of our families, our friends, and our fellow men and women. I know the truth and power of human stewardship of our lands, our waters, and our skies, and I will try to act to preserve our environment. I know the truth and power of the sciences of mathematics, of physics, and of chemistry, and of the important role of these disciplines in understanding the workings of this cosmos. I know the truth and power of the rejection of all notions or beliefs, that reside in the supernatural or the superstitious, and of those notions or beliefs that we are not supposed to be able to explain. And I know that these rejections are necessary for humankind's survival. I am a human being with a free mind, liberated from irrational influence and from unreasonable dogma.